Bless you all. Well, if you get your outlines out with me this morning, on Mother's Day, I don't do a Mother's Day message. On Father's Day, I don't do a Father's Day message. And the reason behind that is because some of you have any mothers, some of you didn't have mothers, and some of you mothers don't want to hear about a standard you can't keep. So as a gift for mothers, I thought I'd talk to the men today and get them all straightened out for you. Just kidding. This message applies to you all. But anyway, Augustine made this statement. He says, sin has two causes, either from not seeing what we ought to do or from not doing what we need, knows that what we see needs to be done. And so what happens is one of the most insidious parts of sin is that of pride. It's where we put ourselves before what God would have us to do. Pride is the most prevalent, or it seems like it is the initiator, if you will, of all sin. Because I believe pride convinces laziness that someone else should do it. I believe pride convinces lust that my pleasure comes before God's priorities. Pride convinces anger that if I don't get my way, someone will have to pay. Pride convinces greed that the more I have, the more that I'll be satisfied. Pride convinces envy that I deserve better than anyone else. And so pride is the most insidious form of arrogance because it's really a form of self-worship. It's placing one's own interest above the interest of God and above the interest of others. So pride thinks that it's all about me. And so I want to talk about that today. The very first verse on your outline is found in James chapter 4. And I'm going to read it to you. It's on the screen this morning or on your outline. And it says this: but he gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. And so it is an interesting verse, and we have two choices there. You and I can be in opposition to God, or we can be in God's greater grace. How many of you would rather be in God's greater grace than in opposition? And so it's a tool that the enemy uses that we would be prideful, because when we're prideful, God won't work. God is opposed to the proud, but he gives a greater grace to the humble. And so it's important that you and I deal with pride, because there's many dangers to pride. There's many pitfalls to pride. And there is a greatness that seems to be when we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of the Lord. Look what it says in Philippians 2:3. It says, do nothing from selfish or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. And see, here again, selfishness. Would you say selfishness with me? I'm going to talk more about this, but selfishness breaks all relationships. You might want to write that down. Selfishness breaks all relationships. And so it's important that we're not self-centered, but we're God-centered. And when we're God-centered, then we'll be other-centered, right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourselves. And so C.S. Lewis, he says, pride is a spiritual cancer. It eats up the very possibility of love or contentment or even common sense. When we are prideful, it even messes with our common sense, because we see things with a wrong perspective. When we have eyes of humility, we see as the Lord sees. Even the Lord who spoke things into existence, who came to this earth, was not served, but he came to what? To serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He is our example of total humility. He is the one who deserved to be worshipped, deserved to be pampered, but yet he came in a humble way to die on the cross for us. There are dangers of pride. Even in that that common sense. If you were to look, it's not on your outline, but in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 13 and 14, it talks about the five I wills. It is really what got Lucifer kicked out of heaven. And he got so filled with himself, so filled with pride, this is what got him kicked out of heaven. And I'll read it for you. But you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. And I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. You see all those filled with pride? And see, it is that pride that deceives us. He himself was deceived, and he then again goes and deceives others. And how does he do it? He does it by trying to get us to bite on that apple of pride, so to speak. And so there are dangers of pride. Write this down. The first one, it sets us up to be deceived. It sets us up to be deceived. And there it is. You see how deceptive he was. In the last days, in the book of Revelation, it amazes me. It's just one angel that's going to take Satan and throw him in the lake of fire. Isn't that amazing? And yet he thinks his power is equal to that of God. And so it's a deceptive thing. And again, he tries to deceive others. Look what happened. We know this in the book of Genesis. Look at Genesis 3, 1 through 5. It says this, now the serpent was the most crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God made. And he said to the woman, indeed, has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, from the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat. But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die. The serpent said to the woman, you surely will not die, for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God. Doesn't that sound familiar? You will be like God, knowing good from evil. Wow. And so we see the deceptiveness of that. God says you can't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because if you eat of it, you shall surely die. And Satan comes and says, what, you can't eat of any tree? See how deceptive he is? He says, you won't die. When you eat it, you'll be just like God, knowing good from evil. Wow. And we experience death in our society and in our world because of this. That sin entered the world. See, it's self-righteousness. It's self-centeredness. It's being that self-sufficient in your life. When the truth is, we need to rely on the things of the Lord. Amen? And so that's why it is so important. It will set you up to be deceived. The Bible says that pride cometh before what? Before destruction, and a high spirit before a fall. And so we see that, and so it sets you up. Pride sets you up for a fall. And so it is so important that you and I have our eyes open to the wiles of pride, because it will deceive you. And then number two, it robs you of genuine relationships. It robs you of genuine relationships. Look what it says in James 4:1, and I put this in the Message Bible, and it says, where do you think all these appalling wars and quarrels come from? Do you think they just happen? Think again. They come about because you want your own way and you fight for it deep inside yourselves. And so, again, we see that genuine relationships, it will rob you, because it will set you up to be up here. And you will become self-centered. And you will end up living for self, and you will break all those other relationships in your life. See, the enemy wants to put that bait in front of you that you will put yourself first. I've had heard people say that, you know what, I put my husband first 3 years, I put my kids first 3 years, now I'm living for self. And their life goes in a huge tailspin away from the things of the Lord. So it's important that we put God first in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
And we foster those healthy relationships. And then number three, it robs you of God's blessing. It will rob you of God's blessing. Again, God is opposed to the proud, but he gives a greater grace to the humble. Look what it says in Proverbs 16:5. Proverbs 16:5 says this: everyone who is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Assuredly, he will not be unpunished. I tell you, you will not have the blessing of the Lord if you are living your life for self. It is so important that you and I follow in humility before the Lord. Because in reality, we are nothing without the Lord. We are nothing. But in Christ, we can do all things. Why? Because of us? No, because of Christ in us. And Christ in us is that hope of glory. Look what it says here in 1 Peter 5:5. It says this: and all of you, clothe yourself with, say with me, humility towards one another, for God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. So, humility. Humility is something that we should clothe ourselves with. In fact, if we can look in a spiritual realm, I believe one of the most underestimated things in a spiritual realm is that clothing of humility. Because it is the very opposite of everything that Satan represents, is humility. Jesus embodies everything of humility. And yet, who are we to set ourselves up? God Almighty came to this earth to be beaten, bruised, and crucified. And who are we to set ourselves up? But you see how the enemy works? He tries to set ourselves up that we are miserable in life, but we are called for humility. Look what it says in 1 Peter 5. We're going to look at verses 6 and 7. He says, therefore, humble yourselves. Say this, humble yourselves. Under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in proper time, casting all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Have you noticed? We as believers, we as a church, we live in a spiritual sense in an upside down kingdom. It's an upside down kingdom because things in a spiritual sense does not make sense in a worldly sense. Because to be exalted, he says, you must be what? Humble. It's completely opposite of the world's value. It is better to give than to receive. If you want to be the greatest, what? Become the least and the servant of all. It is an upside down kingdom that we live in. And so the greatest of those is those who serve, which is Jesus, who gave his whole life, and we are called to give our lives and to therefore humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in a proper time. And so, when we humble ourselves, it is God who exalts us. I had a pastor friend one time, he was telling me the story, and he just hates trash being over the place. And he was telling this story years ago where he was driving to church and he saw that somebody had all their trash and it was right in the roadside. And he drove by that and he said, it just bothered him. And so he got to church early, he had to go back and pick up his wife, and he said he passed it again. And he said, it so bothered me again. And then he says, then I came back to church the third time and I saw that trash there again. And he said, it bothered me. And then he said, on the way home, for the fourth time, he saw that trash there and it bothered him. And he said he felt the Lord say, why don't you go and pick it up if it bothers you? So he didn't tell his wife where he was going. He said he's going to go run some errands. So he said he went over there. He parked down the street so nobody would see him. And he goes there and he gets that trash. And he picks it all up. He puts it in the trunk of his car. And he drives home. Well, the next week after church on Sunday, just the following week, there was a couple that came to church for the first time. And they said, hey, Pastor, we want to meet with you. He said, you know what? We saw you last week. We've never been to your church before, but we knew who you were. And we saw you picking up that trash, and we said to each other, if he cares that much about the trash, I bet you he cares a whole lot about souls. Amen. And you see how the humility of that act brought glory to the Lord. It is a sign of humility. And we see that. We are to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. And the observation is this, you can write it down. True humility is not gained easily. It is gained intentionally. It's not gained easily. It's gained intentionally. And you can write this down. Hidden service is the best way to build humility. See, it was a hidden service that he didn't do for anybody to see. But how many of you know somebody always sees? And it's usually the Lord. And the Lord has a plan and a purpose for all those things. So Paul is urging everyone to close themselves in humility and do our part so God can do his part. Because sometimes in life, we get so caught up in doing things in order to achieve certain things that we forget that God is in control. So we need to recognize and to accept that our purpose here on earth is to glorify the Father, and that is not really done through our own achievements, but rather it's done in what He is able to achieve through us. So to this end, we need to realize that either we need to humble ourselves, or I believe God will humble ourselves for us. I'd rather choose to be humble than to have the Lord humble us. Amen? And I tell you, when you're humble, God will exalt you and He'll make things good for you, and it's good stuff. Humbling yourself is discovering that the greatest joy is in serving others and doing good. The scripture urges us to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. And so again, true humility is not gained easily. It is gained intentionally. And it's not natural for us humans to be humble. On the contrary, we are usually trying to achieve and stand out. However, humbling yourself can help you experience real joy. And again, hidden service is one of the best ways to build humility. I love those who come early in the morning on Sunday, even before I get here. Nobody of you sees them, but they set up the musical equipment, they get the coffee ready, they make sure everything's ready for us. We got some gentlemen who finished our floor, who was here till 10 o'clock last night because they wanted it done for Mother's Day, so it looked nice for the Lord. So, boy, where nobody knows, but the Lord knows. Now you all know because I just gave it up. And it's to the glory of God. Amen?
Amen.
Look what it says in Matthew 6:3. It says, but when you give to the poor, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. In other words, you do it in secret without having to have a pat on the back. Without kind of tooting your own horn, so to speak. There's a story in the Old Testament where after victory, they would blow a horn. It was a symbol of victory. And so somebody else came and took the horn and really didn't have anything to do with the victory, but took the horn and he blew it. And that's where our saying comes from. Don't toot your own horn or toot your own Yeah, that's what he did. He was tooting his own horn. And so, listen, God sees in secret, and God will reward. Amen. And so what we're called to do is, well done, my good and faithful servant. You were faithful. Say faithful.
Faithful
with the little things, and I will put you in charge of many things. So we're to be faithful, and everything we do, listen, we do it for the glory of the Lord. Amen. Just like our adopter block, every week that goes out, every week goes to the adopter block and minister to people. And I love that verse we talked about last week. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. Listen, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And that's what we're about to do. And my question is, when was the last time that you did a hidden service that nobody saw? That you just did it as you're doing it unto the Lord? You remember that verse where it says that the Lord is saying, when I was hungry, you came and you fed me. When I was thirsty, you came and brought me drink. When I was sick, you came to me. When I was in prison, you came and visited me. And they said, Lord, Lord, when did we do these things to you? Jesus said, when you do to the least of these, you do them as unto me. And that's what our new church recovers about, that we are reaching out to the least, the lost, and the last. Those with hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And we are reaching out for the glory of the Lord. Amen. I'm so excited what God is doing. It is sometimes dangerous when we take credit for something we didn't do. There's a story here in Samuel. I'll read the story and then I'll explain it. It says this in 2 Samuel chapter 1, verse 10, and we're going to go up to verse 16. It says this, so I stood beside him and killed him, because I knew that he could not live after he had fallen. And I took the crown which was on his head and the bracelet which was on his arm, and I have brought them here to my Lord. Then David said to him, how is it that you are not afraid to stretch out your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? And David called one of the young men and said, go cut him down. So he struck him and he died. And David said to him, your blood is on your head, for your mouth has testified against you, saying, I have killed the Lord's anointed. So here's what happened. Saul was going out to battle. Saul gets wounded. And he falls upon his sword. He's still alive. And one of the Amalekites, he comes and he's trying to get favor with David because he knows David's going to be the new king. And so he takes his sword and he thrusts Saul with it. He takes off his crown, he takes off his bracelets, and he brings it and he comes to David. And he says to David, basically, I've killed Saul for you, my Lord. And he thought he was going to get a big pat on the back. Instead, he gets the sword up the gut. And here, write this down. Taking credit can sometimes be dangerous. You know what? It never bodes well when we take credit for something. Because how many of you know, if we don't care who gets the credit, but we care what gets done, then we're all blessed. Because ultimately, it should be God who gets the credit, right? Because listen, anything we do in righteousness is as filthy rags to the Lord. But when we do it in the name of the Lord with a right heart, it goes an awful long ways. You know why? Because it's being humble before the Lord, because it is for the Lord and not for ourselves. So taking credit can be dangerous. So be careful. Be careful what you take credit for. Because ultimately, all the glory, all the honor goes to the Lord. And then number two, giving credit is always safe. Giving credit to other people, give credit where credit is due to other people. If somebody wants to give you credit, you say, boy, by God's grace. Amen? It's really true. By God's grace. Because God gives a greater grace to the humble. And he is opposed to the proud. And he'll give you all the grace and all the strength and all the supernatural help that you will need to fulfill the commitment and the purpose that God has for you if you walk in the things of the Lord. And be careful not to raise your hand against the anointing, because it will not be good for you. You will not fulfill your purpose, and you'll have a rough time. So the antidote to pride, write this down. The antidote to pride is the closer you are to God, the more humble you become. The closer we are to the Lord, the more humble we become. You know why? Because we truly get to know who God is. And we realize really how small and insignificant we are apart from Jesus Christ. So listen, get over you. Get over you and get under God. Amen? Get over you and get under God. And close yourself with humility. The last verse this morning is found in Luke chapter 14, verse 11, and it says this: For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. I can remember the first few years of ministry. I was in a city in Riverside, and I can remember in that process the Lord just beginning to humble me. The humble. And listen, God has blessed His church. God has blessed us. And I want to continue in that blessing. And we are to remain humble before the mighty hand of the Lord. How many of you know we live in the last days? How many of you know what's taking place on Monday? Anybody know what's taking place Monday in Israel? Watch the news, you'll see. And I believe it's the beginning, folks, of some awesome things that are taking place from a biblical perspective of what we see, with even Jerusalem being there, the capital. It's crazy stuff. It's been talked about for years, and it's going to be done tomorrow. And so you will see great and awesome and wonderful things take place, and you will see the Bible revealed like you've never seen before. And so God is in control, amen? The enemy knows it's time to kill it. And he wants us to walk in pride. But we're going to walk under the mighty hand of the Lord. Amen. Amen. We're going to pray. I'm going to invite the worship team to come forward. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word today. Lord, I thank you that you are so great. You are so awesome. And Lord, apart from you, we are nothing. But Lord, thank you for that covenant relationship that we have with you. That everything you have, we have because of that covenant relationship that you allow us to have with you. Lord, thank you. Lord, that you died upon the cross for all of our sins. All of our shame, all of our guilt, all of our shortcomings, Lord, you died and nailed them to the cross. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst, that your presence is so evident. Lord, as we see lives changed, as we see people coming to you, people baptized, and people's lives being transformed from the inside out. Lord, thank you for your wonderful presence. Lord, thank you for the calling that we have to go out and to preach the good news. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. And Lord, I thank you for all the mothers that are here today. Lord, would you bless them? Would you honor them, Lord? Would you give them strength? Lord, thank you for the many sacrifices that they have. And Lord, through the example of moms that are humble and are servants. So Lord, we bless you. And we honor you this day. And Lord, that we are not worthy. So forgive us, Lord. As you came in the most humble of humble ways. Born in an animal stable, Lord, where it probably wasn't very pleasant, but Lord, you came very humble. You died, Lord, humbly for us. Oh, Lord, thank you for your humility and your humbleness that died and now you are exalted. And Lord, help us to have the right perspective of who we are in you. That we would close ourselves with humility And Lord, this day we bless you and we honor you. And in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
Amen.